Hello friends, I hope you all are fine. In this video, I will discuss about the vasa previa. This is also one of the cause of the antepartum hemorrhage. What is vasa previa? It is clear from its name, as it is derived from the Latin word. Vasa means vessels, that are the fetal blood vessels. Pre means before, and the via means way. In other words, vessels that are the fetal blood vessels lie before the fetus in the birth canal. As you can see in this diagram, these are the fetal blood vessels which lie before the fetus in the birth canal. This is a placenta. These are the fetal blood vessels. This is umbilical cord in the orange color. Umbilical cord actually contains the fetal blood vessels, which is covered with the Watson jelly. It is actually a gelatinous substance which protects the fetal blood vessels. But here, the Watson jelly is absent, so these blood vessels are unprotected. So there are the more chances of rupturing of the fetal blood vessels. Definition: vasa previa is a term used when fetal blood vessels lies over the internal os of the cervix in front of the presenting part. This is a fetal blood vessels which is present or lies over the, this is an internal os, lies over the internal os of the cervix in front of the presenting part or before the presenting part. Next is the incidence. The chances of vasa previa is actually very rare, that is 1 among the 2000 births. Vasa previa actually occurs rarely, but it is a very serious condition, as this is a serious cause of vaginal bleeding. Next are the risk factors of vasa previa, or these are considered as a causes of vasa previa. First one is velamentous insertion of umbilical cord. Normally the umbilical cord is attached at the middle of the placenta, but in this case the umbilical cord is attached at the margins. As you can see in this diagram, this is a placenta, and in this case the umbilical cord is attached at the margins, so there are the more chances of vasa previa. Next is the multi-lobed placenta, or we can also say the bilobed placenta, sexcenturate placenta. As you can see in this diagram, this is placenta, this is also placenta. This is the one lobe of placenta, while this is another lobe of placenta. So this is known as bilobed placenta. So these both lobes are attached with the fetal blood vessels. So in the case of multi-lobed placenta or bilobed placenta, there are the more chances of vasa previa. Next is IVF, that is in vitro fertilization. In the case of in vitro fertilization, this is one of the artificial fertilization. In this case, there are the more chances of abnormal placentation. Maybe the placenta is attached at the lower uterine segment. This is also one of the cause of vasa previa. Placenta previa, when the placenta is attached at the lower uterine segment. Next is the multiple pregnancies. So in the case of twins, then again there are the chances, because of the non-availability of the space at the upper uterine segment, the placenta may attach at the lower uterine segment, or there are the more chances of velamentous insertion of umbilical cord, which may lead to vasa previa. Next is pathophysiology. Due to the etiological factors or due to the risk factors, blood vessels are present at the membranes without protection. Membranes that are amnion and chorion. So the blood vessels are present, fetal blood vessels are present at the membranes without any protection, that is without the Watson jelly, or we can also say without the umbilical cord or placental tissues. During labor, when the membranes ruptured, so when the amnion and chorion is ruptured, the fetal blood vessels are also ruptured. So there will be a damage to the fetal blood vessels, and because of that damage to the fetal blood vessels, there will be a bleeding, which leads to fetal exsanguination. Exsanguation means severe blood loss, which can even cause death, and the fetal death. Because of the severe blood loss, death may occur. Why there is a fetal exsanguination? Because in the case of Vasa Previa, the blood loss is fetal. There will be a fetal blood loss. Normally in the case of Placenta Previa or in the case of Abruptio Placenta, when the placenta is prematurely separated, in that case, the blood loss will be maternal. But in the case of Vasa Previa, the blood loss is fetal. So that's why there is a fetal exsanguination and death. So there are the chances of fetal mortality is very high. High fetal mortality, that is 50 to 70% chances of fetal death in this case. Next are the diagnosis of Vasa Previa. Before discussing the diagnosis, one thing should be clear in mind, that in case of Vasa Previa, the blood loss will be fetal. Classic triad. So in the classic triad, first one is membranes ruptured. As we know that the fetal blood vessels are present in the membranes, that is amnion and chorion. And if these membranes ruptured, then what happened? Fetal blood vessels are also ruptured or damaged. So if the fetal blood vessels are ruptured, as a result, painless vaginal bleeding occurs, plus fetal bradycardia. Because of the decreased blood supply to the baby, the fetal heart rate is decreasing or decreased, or fetal death may occur because of the fetal blood loss. So when there will be a vaginal bleeding, to find out the cause behind it, these two tests mainly done. First one is color flow Doppler ultrasonography should be done to find out the cause behind the vaginal bleeding. Next one is Singer's alkali denaturation test or detection of nucleated RBCs or fetal HB. So when there is a vaginal bleeding, to find out the cause behind the vaginal bleeding, this diagnostic test should be performed to find out or to detect the fetal blood cells. If there is a presence of fetal blood cells, then as we know that the blood loss is only fetus, so the cause behind the vaginal bleeding is Vasa Previa. But if the fetal blood cells are not present in the vaginal bleeding, that means the cause behind the vaginal bleeding may be Placenta Previa or maybe Abruptio Placenta. But if the fetal blood cells are present, it means the blood loss is fetal. As a result, the cause behind the bleeding is Vasa Previa. Next are the complications of Vasa Previa. A woman in labor. So during the first stage of labor, there will be a cervical dilatation. The cervix is dilated during the first stage of labor. Fetal blood vessels at the cervix. So fetal blood vessels are present over the internal os of cervix. So there are three possibilities. These fetal blood vessels may not rupture because of some reason. The second possibility is these fetal blood vessels may compressed. So as because of the uterine contractions, it pushes the baby's head downwards or baby's presenting part downward, which compresses the fetal blood vessels. So if the fetal blood vessels are compressed, it decreases the blood supply to the baby. So if there is a decreased blood supply to the baby, it leads to decreased fetal heart rate or intrauterine growth retardation or maybe the intrauterine death of the baby. So the third possibility is fetal blood vessels may ruptured. So if the fetal blood vessels ruptured, there will be a rapid blood loss, and the blood loss will only be fetal. Decreased blood supply to the baby. So if there is a huge blood loss, there is decreased blood supply to the fetus, which leads to fetal extenuation. That result in stillborn baby, that is the baby born dead, or we can also say there will be an intrauterine death of the baby. So these are the complications of vasa previa. At last, there is the management of vasa previa. Management will only depend on the fetal gestational age, that whether the mother is pregnant for the complete 37 weeks or not. Severity of the condition, that how much there is a blood loss, whether the membranes are ruptured or not, whether the blood vessels are ruptured or compressed. Next is persistence, means continuous or reoccurrence or repeated bleeding. Continuous or repeated bleeding. Presumed cause of bleeding. That what is the cause of bleeding? That whether the membranes are ruptured or compressed. If the pregnancy is more than 37 weeks or equal to 37 weeks, plus if the bleeding is occurring again and again or repeatedly occur, then immediate delivery should be recommended. But the mode of delivery only depends upon the state of the fetus. If there is a less bleeding, or we can say if there is no any continuous bleeding, in that case vaginal delivery can be done by the expert hands. But if there is a recurrent bleeding or persistent bleeding, in that case immediate cesarean section should be done. Next one is expectant management. Expectant management in the case when the pregnancy is less than 37 weeks, when the baby is not mature enough. In that case, expectant management can only be done in the selected cases for the fetal maturity. So if there is no any persistent bleeding, there is no recurrent episodes of bleeding, in that case only expectant management should be done. As you can see, here it is written in the selected cases only. But if there is a continuous bleeding, in that case corticosteroids should be given. That is to mature the fetal lungs, and the immediate delivery should be done. So in the selected cases, if there is no any persistent bleeding, there is no continuous bleeding, in that case fetal monitoring should be done carefully. That is, the fetal heart rate should be done carefully. If it is decreased, means there is a decreased blood supply to the baby, or there are the chances of fetal death. So immediate management should be done. Plus the neonatal blood transfusion may be needed because the blood loss is fetal. So in that case, in the case of huge blood loss, neonatal blood transfusion may be needed. So this is the management of vasa previa. Guys, if you find my videos really useful, then please share it with your classmates. And if you have any kind of query regarding vasa previa, then please ask me in the comment section. At last, stay safe, stay at home.